Get started. I'm thrilled that you're here. My name is Joe Tesi. I'm the Associate Director of Undergrad Admissions at Binghamton University. I'm thrilled that you're going to join us today. I know we have a lot of students that are sort of out there kind of, you know, looking for what the best university, the best school is, a right fit for them is. And we love Binghamton University. We're going to talk a lot about Binghamton University. We're going to talk about who we are. But most importantly, you know, this message today has everything to do with our alumni. You know, they were there in your shoes at one time, kind of searching for what school would I want to go to? Who do I want to become? It seemed so big and large at the time. They found their pathway. And I think the message is strong that Binghamton University will help you find your pathway. You guys know that, you know, the accolades at Binghamton are amazing. You know, Binghamton is ranked as a public Ivy, you know, Ivy League quality education, but at a public school price, right? We're a public school, affordability, accessibility, diversity, all those things you could want in a school. You should not have to graduate college with a lot of debt. You should have lots of opportunity when you graduate. So we're here to talk about Binghamton. You know, return on investment. When I graduate, will I have a lot of debt? And will I have lots of opportunities? So our alumni that are here today are here to talk about that. You know, the title of today's presentation and session is, you know, where are they now? Which is a cool session. We've never done anything like this before. It's our first time. So I'm thrilled to bring that to you. And I'm thrilled that you're here with us. And so as we'll go around and introduce ourselves real quick, and we'll have a presentation. And as you're here, just if you have questions, just sort of throw them right in our chat. And we'll answer those questions kind of at the end of our session. So let's meet. Let's get started. If I could have our presenters, Erica, start with presenting or introducing yourself.
Sure. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm excited to be here today. My name is Erica Christ, and I'm the Senior Associate Director for Career Experiences and Education in our Fleischman Center for Career and Professional Development. So that's the main career services center that serves all graduate and undergraduate students at Binghamton. And I'm going to tell you a little bit more about what the Fleischman Center does for students in a little bit, but happy to be here today.
Hi, everybody. My name is Carrie Feierabman. I'm one of our admissions counselors here at Binghamton University. I'm going to kind of duck behind the scenes on the back end after introducing myself here. I will be taking a look at all of your questions, and I will be fielding them and asking the appropriate alumni once they're done giving their presentation. So feel free to use that Q&A function, and we'll be fielding those questions at the end of the presentation. So thank you all for joining us, and we look forward to answering those questions soon.
Hi, my name is Gerardo, but a lot of my friends call me Jerry. People at work call me Jerry as well. I graduated from Binghamton both in 2019 and 2020. In 2019, I graduated with my bachelor's in political science, and in 2020, I graduated with my MBA in finance.
Hi, my name is Ian Storch. I am a board-certified internal medicine doctor and gastroenterologist. I practice gastroenterology on Long Island in New York. And I graduated from Binghamton in 1995.
Great, thank you. Majeen.
Hi, everyone. My name is Majeen Garcon. I am an attorney with the City of New York. I pretty much handle government defense and pretty much all their personal injury matters with all the city agencies. I went to Binghamton in 2010 to 2015. I graduated with a political science and sociology minor. And of course, I love Binghamton. I'm a Bearcat.
My name is Kimberly Dykeman. I proudly still live in the state of New York, which planned quite a few hats. Currently, I have a business. It's Kimberly Dykeman Enterprises. I'm also the co-CEO of one of the largest triathlon groups in the country, which is a Los Angeles Triathlon Club.
Wow. Well, thank you, guys. Listen, what we're going to do now, if you don't mind, Erica is going to speak about career development and how important that is for our students at Binghamton University. So Erica, it's all yours.
Thank you so much. So I'm going to share a little bit about the opportunity students have at Binghamton to kind of get a head start on their careers, whether that be going right into the workforce after graduation or pursuing graduate or professional school, and how we help students do that at the Fleischman Center. We're really focused on career development through all four to however many years it takes students, but usually 4 years, through your college experience to ensure that you are accessing the opportunities to build skills and to build connections that are going to help you as you enter the job market and as you apply to graduate school and professional school in the future. So there are a few ways that we do that and ways that we make these resources available to students. The first thing that's really important, we work with students who are focused on identifying what their career interests are. So we have a lot of students who come into Binghamton undecided, or maybe they feel they're decided at the time they enter school, but over the course of their time in college, you take different classes, you're exposed to new information, and you might find your passion lies in other areas. So a lot of what we do, especially for our first year and sophomore students, is around exploring majors and career options. And so some of that might be working one-on-one with students. So we have staff who are career consultants and they meet with students one-on-one to talk about their values and their skills and what their interests are and connecting those to different career fields. We also have assessments that students can take, career assessments, and then we'll work with them to kind of, what do these results mean? Do I have to pick one of these careers or what other options do I want to explore or talk to some alumni about? And then we also offer some career classes that students can take. So we have a career exploration course that we teach in the summer and in the winter terms for students to kind of take a deep dive into figuring some of this out. You know, career and major are very closely connected, but at the same time, your major opens doors to a lot of different career paths. And I think you're going to hear a little bit of that today. So, you know, we have individuals who may have graduated with an English degree or a political science degree. You could take that in so many different direction. So what we like to help students do is figure out what does that path look like? Because it's not a straight line. It might be more of a squiggly line to figure out where you want to go. So we talk a lot with students about their career options. The other thing that we're really focused on at Binghamton is making sure that our students are able to gain relevant experience while they're at Binghamton. And so there's a couple of different ways that students can do that. You can engage in internships throughout your college career. Through the Fleischmann Center, we have a credit-bearing internship program that students can start earning credit for internships as early as their sophomore year. And there are also a ton of internship opportunities on campus for students, as well as in the local community. So you might think, okay, the summer after my junior year is where I'm going to do that really intensive summer internship. You can do an internship while you're taking classes for, you know, 10 hours a week and still gain that relevant experience and start building up the skills and the opportunities that you're able to share in your resume. So we spend a lot of time talking to students about how to find those opportunities, how to make connections with alumni, how to make connections with organizations that might be in their field of interest to find opportunities to do internships or shadowing or just do some informational interviewing. We also run an extensive employer trek program. So we work with employers to set up visits where students can go on site. And we'll transition back to that very quickly once we're through this time period with COVID. But we've still been doing them virtually. So students still get that kind of firsthand look at what an employer does, what the culture of their organization is, what the day-to-day looks like in different fields and at different companies, and get to make personal connections with individuals who work at that organization. So our employer treks are a big part of what we do. We also help prepare students obviously for the job and internship search and for graduate school. Usually when students think about a career center, they think like, oh, that's the place I go to get my resume looked at. And we absolutely do that in addition to a lot of other things. But we do work with students on their resumes to make sure that they're really showcasing the skills they have in relation to that position that they're really excited about. So we'll work with students to polish that resume up so that they feel super confident about that document. And then in addition to that, obviously any other parts of the application that move forward, cover letters, anything else, you know, supplemental materials that need to go, we'll work with students on. We also help students with interviewing. And interviewing is obviously a really important part of any job search process or job application process. But it really is a crucial moment where you have the opportunity to talk about all of the great things that you did as a Binghamton student to a potential employer. And so we work with students through mock interviews, as well as through some online resources that they have access to 24/7 to make sure that our students are putting their best foot forward when it comes to interviewing, that they're really able to talk about their experience as a student here, share examples of what they've done, and really talk about their strengths and relation to that position. So that is a lot of what we do in terms of getting students ready for that next step. We'll also obviously help students overall with that job and internship search process. What does it look like? When should I be applying for jobs in my field versus my friend who's in accounting, you know, when they're applying for jobs, because there's a lot of nuances based on the field, and we make sure that our students have that information. And we have a lot of really great resources on our website as well that students can utilize to identify that. And then we also work with students who are applying to graduate or professional school. So at Binghamton, we do have, you know, pre-health advising and pre-law advising, and we work with those offices as well. And then we also help students who are applying to graduate school in a wide variety of fields. Many of our students at Binghamton are first-generation students too. And as a first-generation student myself, I had no idea what I was doing through that process. So we want to make sure that our students have someone they can reach out to say, what does this look like? Talk me through what materials I need. What should I be writing about in this personal statement? All of those different pieces to make sure that students are setting themselves up for success. So those resources are available to you. We have a lot of really signature events for students. We have job and internship fairs, the things that you probably expect when you come to Binghamton. We have a graduate school day and a law day too, where schools come to recruit our amazing students. And then, as I mentioned, we have our employer track. So that's a little bit of all the ways Binghamton tries to engage students in their career and professional development throughout their whole 4 years. And if you want to learn more about what's going on day to day with career services at Binghamton, I encourage you to follow us on social media as well. I just want to put that plug out there. We have a really active Instagram, Bing Fleischman Career Center, that you can follow on Instagram as well as Facebook.
Oh, thank you, Erica. You know, our Fleischman Career Center is just amazing. We prepare students for their careers in just an incredible way. I mean, the Fleischman Career Center mirrors our philosophy academics, you know, experiential learning. Binghamton is an R1 top tier research institution. Experiences, research, on-hand learning experiences, right? So that means internships are critical. It's almost co-curricular in a way. You know, academically, of course, you'll get the support you need. You know, that sense of community at Binghamton is strong. You know, and then stepping to our next steps, what support will I get to build my resume? You know, and have those experiences I need, those connections I need with great alumni, you know, across the country, across the world. So we're thrilled. As a matter of fact, to be a little shy, but the reality is a couple of years back, our Fleischman Career Center won a national award as one of the very top career centers for students on any campus in the nation. Well, that's pretty cool. We're proud of that. We talk a lot about that. So let me do this. Let's get started with our alumni and have them kind of introduce and tell their story. It's kind of really while we're here is to bring some reality to who you can become, right? But first off, I want to talk to Gerardo Amigan. Did I say that right? Class of 19. And then you got your class of 22, your master's degree, an accountant. Currently working as a financial leadership development program at CVS. So Gerardo, if you could talk about that would be great. Thanks.
Absolutely. I think I can start off in talking about my path, connecting it back to my parents. I think that actually their background really shaped me into who I am today. So to give you some background on where they came from, they came from Mexico in their teens as immigrants. The reason they came was because they lived in an extremely impoverished lifestyle, if you will. They literally went to bed hungry. They couldn't afford the right amount of clothing. They had no electricity, so they'd never seen a TV before they came to the United States. Had no air conditioning either. So just like picture the most impoverished developing country. Like that was their lifestyle, and that was like the reason that they came to the United States. And when they did come, they didn't really know the language. They had no type of education, dropped out in like elementary school, middle school, didn't have any money. All they had was motivation. So they came here, they built a lifestyle. 1996 comes around, I'm born, and I go through the New York City public school system. Education isn't top, but you know, I like a lot of families, not everybody can afford top of the line education. So that was all I could afford. That's all my family could afford. In high school, I went to a vocational school. So vocational schools prepare students to join the workforce right away after graduating high school instead of preparing them for college. So I was kind of trained in one trade. It was like a plumbing. So did that in high school. My assistant principal convinced me to go on to college. So I went to junior college because I didn't have the grades to get into Binghamton yet. So kudos to everybody on this call who does have those grades. You guys must be geniuses. So I went to junior college in Brooklyn. And then I graduated, transferred into Binghamton. At Binghamton, I did my undergrad in political science. While I was there, I walked onto the men's soccer team. And because I had an extra year of eligibility, I decided to stay another year for grad school. And at that point, I was kind of determined to go into law school. But I realized, so I had to do a lot of self-reflection. We didn't have a law school at Binghamton. And because there wasn't any law school, I was like, okay, so I definitely want to start grad school at Binghamton, but we don't have a law school. So what do I do? So I self-reflected like hard to try to understand like why I want to go to law school. And I realized one of the main reasons I wanted to go to law school was because for financial reasons, I didn't have it growing up. So I just wanted to make sure my family like later down the line doesn't come across those issues. And that's when I realized I could do that, make that kind of money outside of law. And that's when I decided to pursue the MBA program at Binghamton. I started there. And then in the summer between the two years of the MBA program, I interned with one of my friend's moms, who was my roommate at Binghamton. She got me to intern at her fur coat company in New Jersey over that summer. And that made my resume significantly more competitive for the job recruitment process in the fall. So fall comes around, I'm sending out my applications to a bunch of different companies, and lo and behold, I get an offer from CVS Health. And CVS Health is the company that's number 5 on the Fortune 500. So for anybody who isn't familiar with the Fortune 500, they are the 500 largest companies in the United States by revenue. So that's revenue is just money that comes into the organization through sales of goods or services. So accept my offer, senioritis hits. I'm just enjoying my senior year, graduate in May. And then in June, I start working at CVS. I do my accounting stuff, but then I also were supposed to like give back to the program by joining a bunch of different initiatives that are a part of the program. And something that I hold close to my heart is diversity recruitment. So I help a lot out with the diversity recruitment efforts of our program. So right now we're in the process of initiating relationships with HBCUs and a lot of schools that kind of HBCUs are historically Black colleges and universities. And then also just schools that have a lot of like first-gen students, schools that have a lot of diverse candidates. So that's kind of like what I'm doing now. To be honest, corporate America is, it lacks representation of all diverse groups. And that's something that I really want to impact during my time at CVS. So that's where I am right now. That was my background. And I'll pass it back to Joe.
Wow, that's a great story. Thank you. Madjean Garçon, right? Graduated in 2015. You're a lawyer. You're an assistant corporation counsel in law department in New York City. So can you tell our guests your story?
Sure. Hi, everyone. Again, as he mentioned, my name is May Jean. I am born and raised in Brooklyn, very similar to Gerardo. I'm also a first generation. My parents came from Haiti. I knew I wanted to be a lawyer since I saw like Johnny Cochran on TV defending OJ. I knew I wanted to do exactly what he did. I knew for a fact. How to get there, I don't know. I pretty much went through high school and elementary school knowing I wanted to be a lawyer. When I finally arrived at Binghamton, I was told that, you know, the only way to become a lawyer is you have to be a political science major and you have to do this PPL route. I ended up becoming a political science major. And the first thing I did when I got on campus was find the pre-law advising center and pretty much sit with them so they could help direct me along the way. They had pointed me out to several groups, File for Delta, which is like a group I actually enjoyed joining, which is a pre-law fraternity on campus. And I also joined Thurgood Marshall Pre-Law Society, which was also the pre-law organization on campus. And I loved those organizations. As a member of Thurgood Marshall Pre-Law Society, I was provided the opportunity through our law conference to meet other alumni of Binghamton who were also lawyers. And after speaking to them, I got a little bit more clear of sense of how to pretty much guide my law school, I'm sorry, my college experience. One thing that stood out to me while I was at Binghamton, along with being a part of student activities, was one particular professor I had. She taught constitutional law, it's my sophomore year. Her name is Professor Martinick. Literally the hardest class I've ever taken in college. She had very stringent rules, pretty much Socratic method, asking questions about different cases, pretty much gave me an introduction to what a real law school class would be. That was probably the one class I studied for the hardest. And through talking to her, she saw something in me where she continued to mold me throughout my college experience. She's actually still one of my mentors till this day, X, Y, and many years later. She wrote my recommendation for law school and everything. She pointed me into the direction of the different opportunities Binghamton had to offer. One being a really cool experience that a lot of senior level students at Binghamton had to have, which was you got to spend 3 days in the law firm called Skadden, which is one of the biggest law firms in the country. And while you would go there for these 3 days for X amount of hours, you would meet other alumni at Binghamton who also had the opportunity, who sat in your college suite and pretty much talked about their experience from Binghamton to law school. That obviously piqued my interest and allowed me to meet other alumni who are doing things now, something that I want to do in the future. While at Binghamton, I was provided the opportunity to even intern, as Erica had mentioned earlier. I interned at the Broome County's Public Defender's Office, which probably was one of my very exciting internships I ever did pre-law school, because I was able to interview people who needed representations, pretty much get the story and recommend to the public defenders, hey, maybe you should take this case or maybe it's a conflict. And I don't know any other person pre-law school who didn't go to Binghamton, who didn't have this opportunity. And that's just one of many opportunities I could think of. I was also part of the student conduct board where I represent and also advocacy board, whereas I had the opportunity to advocate for on students' behalf who were facing different student conduct issues. After I graduated from Binghamton, when I went to law school, it actually ended up being a great thing because a lot of law schools throughout New York City, you will find a Binghamton alumni and you will find someone who can help walk you through law school and the experiences that you may have. What ended up happening while in law school, I ended up gaining another mentor while I was there who was also a Binghamton alumni who pretty much walked me through my career. Now that I'm actually practicing, and basically as I said earlier, what I do is government litigation. My first job and my first interview was with another Binghamton alumni who pretty much, we spent the whole interview talking about Binghamton. So one thing I will credit to Binghamton is, yes, I went to Binghamton knowing exactly I wanted to be an attorney. However, I've met so many other alumni and will provide so many opportunities that it made the transition from college to law school to my career very seamless. And even to this day, wherever you are in this world, wherever you are in New York, you will find a Binghamton alumni and they're always more than happy to help you. And that's one thing I will always credit to my experience at Binghamton.
Yeah, that's great. Thank you. That's a great story. Okay, so Dr. Ian Storch, class of 95, you are a gastroenterologist and well-known in Long Island. If you could tell us your story.
Thank you very much, Joe. Hi, guys. Good to be here today. My name is Ian Storch. Obviously, the background, Joe, is a little different than yours. Sort of the end of my educational experience was at University of Miami, and I was giving another lecture today, and it's not that I'm proud that I'm not proud of Binghamton or more proud of University of Miami, but the backdrop, I think, living in New York is a little toastier and nicer. Sorry about that. But yeah, so my name is Ian Storch. I am a gastroenterologist. I actually am the, my parents are from New York, but neither of them went to college. And I originally grew up with aspirations of being an English teacher. And I really didn't know where to go to school. I had an older cousin who's now an attorney, who's a really smart and good guy. And he went to Binghamton. So I said, you know what? My cousin Heath went to Binghamton. That sounds like a good option for me also. I spent obviously 4 years at Binghamton, starting off again with aspirations of being an English professor. And, you know, while I was in Binghamton, I lived with another student who always wanted to be an ER doctor. And through an experience, seeing an accident actually at Binghamton, where we helped out a poor woman who was, you know, hit by a motor vehicle, you know, I became very upset that if I had been at that accident without Gary, my roommate, you know, I wouldn't have been able to help. So I joined EMS both at Binghamton. You know, I became an EMT both on campus and in one of the local towns. And ultimately, you know, my parents, you know, I'm a Jewish kid from Long Island. So, you know, Jewish parents from Long Island always want their kids to be doctors or lawyers. So English teacher would have been great. But, you know, I decided maybe I would be an EMT. And they said, wouldn't it be, you know, amazing if you became a doctor, maybe you could help people more. So I thought about it a little bit and I decided to go to medical school. You know, I went from Binghamton to medical school, which is quite an expense. And then I spent 7 years doing a residency here on Long Island at North Shore University Hospital. I did a chief year, which is a big honor that they offered me. It's a teaching year. Unfortunately, it doesn't pay very well, and the loans continue to accrue. And then I went to, you know, as I stated, I went to University of Miami for my gastroenterology fellowship and was really blessed to be given a position there. And I spent 3 years there. And before I went to Miami, I met my wife, who is from Long Island, and I promised her that if she didn't love Miami, we would come back. And although she did love Miami, she missed her mom, and we came back to Long Island to practice. But I would have to say that, you know, I've been very blessed with my career and my practice. I'm in private practice on Long Island, but it all started with Binghamton. And if I didn't have that foundation of Binghamton, I wouldn't be where I am today. And if I didn't have, again, a small loan from Binghamton, I did have a large loan from medical school that I did pay off, but it was very helpful that I didn't saddle myself with debt before I went on this journey. And I'm forever grateful to Binghamton for, again, giving me all the opportunities to be where I am today and not killing me with debt.
That's true. That's a very good point. That's a very good point. Okay, our next alum is Kimberly Dykeman. She owns Kimberly Dykeman Enterprises. She's an entrepreneur, right? Not only that, former international TV host, an author, and a motivational speaker. So Kimberly, can you tell us your story?
Happily. First of all, thank you folks for taking the time. You know, it's funny. As much as I've interviewed people and along my lifeline in my career in a couple different ways, I've also been interviewed, and I like this little phrase that I've come up with, that my career, like my life, is like an etch-a-sketch. It's beautiful when you step back, but man, it's like all little pieces. You don't know what they're gonna look like when you're trying to build it, but it's sparkling. Yeah, so I realize I'm the eldest here of the alum, graduating in 94. In 94, you know, the speakers here, when Hotmail was first coming out, like first getting an email address, which was crazy. So I'll make this as short and sweet as possible, because I've crammed in a lot in my X years on this planet. I actually come from a background of quite a few teachers and professors. So that was over my head, that like, Kimmy, pick a college or you're going to Dutchess in the truck with your dad, because my dad was a professor at Dutchess Community College. So that was, I'll make a decision, not to worry. And my sister had gone to Geneseo, and so I just kind of pulled the trigger and picked Binghamton, not knowing so much what I was going to get into, but I thought it sounded pretty good. And I look good in green or something. I'm sure I said something to myself. I entered and exited not knowing what I was going to do, which is kind of ironic, since I thought at least one of my parents or a cousin would have said, Kimmy, you should go do this. But I didn't ever hear that. So I went in and picked the degree with the fewest books to buy, which was literature and rhetoric. And I thought, this sounds great. I look back on that today. I've used every ounce of my college experience from the communications class, public speaking, Shakespeare, men's lives, karate. I've literally, if I write down every class I ever took, I have pulled something from that in something in my life or part of my career path. And I think there's a beautiful curiosity about that, because I never would have known that all of the things that I was just trying to stitch together to figure out what to do when I leave that campus, they're all just these golden nuggets. You know, when I finished college, I thought I was going to get out of New York State and just kind of said goodbye to everyone. And my path is really kind of messy, but I love it. And if I hadn't had this understanding of I can figure something out, don't worry about it, then I don't know if I ever would have left New York. I do believe that a few of the times talking to my teachers at or my professors at length after classes, talking to some of the career counselors, probably not enough, but enough to feel that if I don't have a decision when I leave school, it's going to be okay. My path is just kind of odd. I didn't think that I would get into the fitness world, but that's actually how my whole journey started. Because somebody had an impression on me. I went from New York down to Florida, and then I followed a boy up to Michigan and had a great personal trainer and thought, okay, maybe I should touch people's lives doing fitness. During that time that I actually got certified as a fitness professional, I wrote a mission for my, kind of like a mission statement of my life. This is what I want to do through my career, whatever it looks like. And it was to motivate, educate, and activate people to live life better, be healthier, be happier, do something more. And I need to be the catalyst in that. So if I weave through my career, which I'll walk you through real quickly, it's through that. So it doesn't matter if it's all messy. I don't think life is supposed to be linear. So I went from being a fitness professional to getting into stress management coaching for executives, thinking, well, 12 more push-ups doesn't change your life. Maybe you need to look at the bigger picture. So I made up a career, made up a coaching methodology called Survival of the Fittest, and got into executive coaching, and had moved to Austin, Texas. And right before the big old .com burst, I focused in on technology companies and mostly men, because I thought they don't always want to talk. So maybe I can push myself in there. So I went into executive coaching, and from that, realized I had some interesting nuggets to share and got into speaking and actually got into writing. And I thought someday on my bucket list, I'll check off, get published. So I started writing these little motivational nuggets to my clients called little soapbox vignettes that ended up going into a old fashioned email, and people started forwarding it. And I had people all over the world emailing me saying, I read this little nugget and it changed my life. And I thought, oh, maybe I'm supposed to do something more with that. Go back. If I hadn't taken that Shakespeare class with Professor Whittier, I don't know if I would have thought I have the skills to write and do something with it. So coaching, got into speaking. I got into television as like by winging it. I pitched all the stations in Austin, Texas about doing a little motivational segment. And one station said, sure, why not, right? And I started doing a little series and realized I'm not scared of TV. And maybe I could get through that lens and somehow affect people. If Oprah can do it, I can do it. I'm not kidding you. I even wrote up a t-shirt that says that. And someday, I eventually have a niece, and she got a t-shirt that says, my Aunt Kimmy is on Oprah Winfrey show, but that never happened. But anyway, you gotta have goals. So I thought if Oprah can do it, I can do it. And I ended up slowly getting into the entertainment world, doing little commercials and weird, you know, little spots here and there, moved to LA on a wing and a prayer, because I believe if you don't go, you'll never know. And got into doing infomercials around the world and interviewing people like, I don't know, Andy Roddick and Elton John and John Legend and some cool people like that. And some really incredible thought leaders like Guy Kawasaki and, you know, some folks from Microsoft and the Hallmark Channel. and really paid attention and asked big questions that I kind of put their answers away and realized that definitely life is not meant to be linear, but pay attention and ask questions. So I left LA at some point, thought that's enough, moved back to Austin, Texas, and just kept pushing ahead. Did more television work and producing, and found some crazy woman who said, I'll publish a book for you. So I got published. My book is called Pure Soapbox. It's probably not in print anymore, but I ended up building a whole brand around that called the Soapbox brand. And put 10 more years into Austin, and again, look back at my college input and realize that, again, each person that I took the time to ask big questions to were my long-term mentors or mentors from afar. Because when you're, as an entrepreneur, as you're blazing your own path, you don't always have somebody who's doing exactly what you are doing or what you want to do. It's not like I could call Oprah Winfrey and say, hey, I want to be a TV host. How do I do that? Or I want to get a book published, but it's kind of like this and not like that. Maybe there's not always a person that is right in front of you that can tell you how to do it. So I'm a big believer in looking back at the people that did cross your path, that did say the right things, and to stow that away and pull that up later on in your path and your career choices. So finishing up in Austin, I thought I would stay there for a long, long time. I ended up getting an illness like a handful of years into it, and kind of wiped me out for about 3 years. And then I realized I can survive. I found a really great doctor. And then I felt like the Lord told me to come back to New York State to be a really great aunt and to be really participatory in my one niece's life and to kind of guide her on where she could go in life. So I moved back to New York in about, 3 years ago. And I had no idea what I was going to do again, but I found by accident an incredible career coach who coached people in Luxembourg of all things for about 30 years and was a teacher and moved back to the United States. So I spent about 3 months working with her and literally felt like a college kid again. What am I supposed to do? These are all my skills. These are my experiences. I want to motivate people and guide them and get stress out of their lives and help them have a happier life. And from those conversations, just like when I was a kid in college, I came up with a different idea. And so today I still help people, but I launched a business as a personal assistant and private concierge, and I manage some significant people's properties. And I get to eliminate their stress and motivate them to have more time in their lives to do what they really want to pursue. So if you can see, it's a little bit of a mess, and yet I really paid attention to the right people and asked the right questions. And my takeaway for you on that point is to don't worry if you don't see someone doing what you think you want to do. Always ask questions and don't be afraid of that. Don't be afraid of the answers either. I didn't get an MBA, but I swear I paid enough to get one, a long life's journey. I would say I've always had a job, when I was in college and just getting out. I think working for other people and staying humble is important, and realizing that really your boss is yourself. Like, you're working for you to better yourself, to make money, to hit goals, to make yourself proud, not so much to clock in for somebody else. So, and then I would also think that you should have some fun. I really do. I've made a mess along the way. I'm literally the black sheep of the family, even though I've never gotten in trouble. But I think I've done it a great way, which is my way, and I've thoroughly enjoyed it. I'm proud to be a New Yorker. I'm proud to have graduated from Binghamton University. And one last thing, my dad was smart enough when I was a kiddo to realize that any college is going to be expensive. Binghamton was definitely not expensive compared to others. But we took about 8 acres of our land and planted Christmas tree saplings by hand. My dad, my sister, and me, when I was like this big, planted Christmas trees. They grew. We sold them. That was my college fund. So I entered and exited college without any debts. So there's an idea for you. You can
you cannot dig a hole before you get there, which is a good idea. Wow. So anyway, that's my long story short. Thank you again for listening. And I hope that it inspires you a little bit.
Thank you. That's a great metaphor. I love the Christmas tree metaphor. That's so cool.
No joke. Yeah. Wow. 3,000 of them. That was fun.
That's amazing. Yeah, you know, I just find a common theme with all of our stories. And I'm an alum too at a class of 86. So yes, I am older than you, Kimberly. So the thing is, you know, like leaving Binghamton with very little debt, but lots of opportunities, right? That sense of community so strong. The support you get, not just academically, but people that are really authentically behind you. My favorite number about Binghamton is retention rate. You know, Binghamton's retention rate, means you retain our students, is 92%. I love that. It's like one of the top retention rates in the country. It means not only are our students brilliant, but they're happy and they stay and they graduate on time and get all the support they need. So I think we're all very proud of Binghamton and we're proud to bring that story to you. Can I ask Carrie to come up back up for us?
Yes.
Questions go back there. Can you, again, we have to be timely now, everyone. We have like 18 minutes left.
We do. We do have a few questions, but there's one I'd really like to start off with to kind of address each of our panelists. And I know some of you guys touched on this, but we would love to hear an expansion on either a research or just a general experience with a professor that impacted you to this day, whether it's a research experience, or I know, Medjine, you mentioned having your professor who really has kind of guided you and you consider mentor even today. So perhaps you could each kind of share a tidbit or an experience or story that you have from your time at Binghamton with regards to a professor relationship.
Yes, as I talked about earlier, my very first introduction to a form of like a law school class was with Professor Martinick. She taught constitutional law, which was the first introduction that we had. She pretty much structured her class like a traditional law school class where she'd be asking about different cases, asking you to theorize and pretty much provide legal arguments for different constitutional law cases that you would have. She ended up becoming a mentor for me even after that class, because she pointed me along the way to different other political science classes that would give me similar experiences, along with pointing me to different internship opportunities on campus and off campus that would also give me the opportunity to see lawyers at work. Throughout that experience, we developed a friendship, a more of a mentorship together. And she pretty much directed me as far as through my law school experience and how to appear as a strong candidate when I'm applying to law school. So that's definitely a experience that I will always cherish, because I would have had the opportunity. And she gave me the opportunity my sophomore year of college. So there, it pretty much guided my whole college experience.
So the interesting thing, I think, as I mentioned, you know, I was an English major in college and I ended up doing pre-med sort of later on. But, you know, I just had a great relationship with all of my English professors. And I think it gives me a little extra dimension as a physician that I wasn't pre-science all the way. But specifically for relationship, you know, the most interesting thing to me is that, you know, I was actually on the fencing team. It's a little odd, but for a brief time at Binghamton, a couple of my roommates fenced and I decided to do it with them. It's not an activity that I do currently, but the pre-health advisor was a guy named Tom Langhorne. And again, I'm getting a little old myself, but, you know, I fenced with Tom Langhorne and he really helped advise.
And he's still the advisor.
Yeah. Yes. I spoke to him recently. You know, that's the full circle of the story. So, So there was a question from Binghamton and they needed kind of a doctor opinion. And I ended up talking to Dr. Langhorne again. I hate calling him Tom because it's a little odd. Just, I remember him as my pre-health advisor, but he was so kind and so helpful. And such a good person, such a good resource to guide me. And the fact that he's still at Binghamton after all these years, and I was able to, you know, thank him for setting me on my path. And, you know, again, allowing me to get to where I am today was really a nice thing.
Gerardo?
Yeah, I think in terms of relationships with professors, it's really what you make of it. Similar to like a lot of what colleges, it's like if you put yourself out there, you're gonna get results. Like in terms of the professors, they're, from my experience, everyone who I reached out to was super helpful with any question. They always like to keep an open line of communication, try to get back to you as soon as possible. And I think same goes with like a lot of like mentorship experiences. It's kind of happen. You know, it's not like you don't really formally ask somebody, "Hey, my mentor." You kind of, the relationship just kind of starts, and you know, it just happens. And that was like my relationship with my professors. It's some of them, it was all natural. Like if we got along, we got along. So yeah.
Jeez. I'm having a hard time it's been a while. It's like, I have to sit and pull up a folder that has files in it of names. Cause I've crossed the country 13 times. So I have to stare at somebody and go, okay, let me find the folder. So finding the folder of professors is tough. I had a mass communications teacher. I can't remember his name. He was strict and darling. And there was something about, he allowed me to ask questions that were maybe off topic. He allowed me to chat with him after class, I remember, because I felt like I had ideas stirring of, I don't know. There was something going on in my head when I was sitting in class, and maybe that was the beginning of, you're going to do something with this down the road. So don't be bashful and ask lots of dumb questions if need be. But he was pretty like malleable and open about that. I can't remember his name, but he had this interesting presence. He also loved explaining how, I mean, it was really like a sociology class, how communications and media and all different like verticals affect us and vice versa, how we're a mirror and yet we're mirrored. There was something really magical about it, the way he painted pictures. And I think that was what stuck with me. And so I do recall little bubbles happening that, well, maybe this is somebody who's actually hitting me in the right spot to help me figure out what the fa-la-la I'm going to do when I leave this college with the little piece of paper. And I will say Professor Whittier, I do remember her name. She was my Shakespeare teacher. And I remember her saying something like, you know, it's just English. Like, what's the problem with people reading and understanding Shakespeare? It's, you know, these words. It was just the way she kind of knocked everyone on the head and just, and honestly, it wouldn't matter if it's Shakespeare or not. Sometimes we try to like confuse things for no reason. And she was the first person that, you know, just kind of made something that we were making complicated simple. So thank you, Professor Whittier. Makes sense. Yeah. To this day, I still have that book, the Shakespeare book, that's this thick.
Erica, you know, maybe you have a question or so for our guests, for our alumni, that maybe for the perspective of, I don't know, career development, you want to bring anything to this?
Sure, yeah. I think along those same lines, you know, I think that it was touched on here and there throughout your introductions, you know, in your stories. Were there, outside of the class, experiences, internships, student orgs that you were involved in that you feel like were really crucial, you know, to where you are now? They helped you build a skill that you continue to use or form connections that you continue to use, things along those lines. So an experience outside of the classroom.
Yeah, and I think it goes back to kind of like what Kimberly was saying before, where she just kind of pulled stuff from kind of every single class. And for me, it was like stuff from every single extracurricular thing I was involved in. I think one of my biggest recommendations is get as involved as you possibly can to the students. Try to meet as many people as you possibly can. The more experiences you have, the more you're going to be able to talk about what, with just anybody. And you can be able to create those relationships because you have things in common that you can both talk about. I was on the men's soccer team. I think things I pulled from there, probably like strong work ethic, the ability to work in a team. I worked at the Fleischmann Center with Erica my final year before I graduated. That was amazing. I think that really set me up for entering a corporate setting. Fleischmann Center, by the way, fantastic career center. Shout out to them. They're all the help, they'll give you any kind of help that you need with the career advising. So that was great. And then I did like, I think four or five, maybe six internships. Most of them were unpaid up until the last one. Finally got that paid internship. So that finally paid off. But yeah, try to get involved with as much extracurricular stuff as you can, because I think it'll benefit you.
Boy, Jean, can you talk about that?
Yes, I can echo everything that Gerardo said completely. I was really involved on campus when I was there. I was a part of Black Student Union, which gave me a really great opportunity. When I was vice president of Black Student Union, I was able to negotiate a contract to bring our celebrity speaker for that year's Black History Month, which ended up being Stephen A. Smith. And understanding what a writer is and, you know, all that fun stuff in college. Along with being on the Black Student Union, I was also vice president of Thurgood Marshall Law Society, where we were able to hold mock trials, which at that time, it was around the same time with the whole big Chris Brown versus Rihanna thing. And we did a fake mock trial, and, you know, I was Chris Brown's attorney, and we, you know, pretty much defended it, played it out in court. Along with that, I was, as I said before, I was a student advocate. So I defended students when they had different conduct issues on campus. So all of that, all those experiences, being a leader, organizing, throwing events, negotiating contracts, those are all things that I presently still do today. Again, as working for the city of New York, as you can imagine, we are hit consistently with lawsuits. So pretty much what I do on an everyday basis is negotiate and litigate. So I credit that to Binghamton for sure, because that gave me an opening before I even went to law school. So I will say Binghamton is hands down responsible for that. Wow.
Ian, can you talk about extracurriculars or things you might remember back in the day?
Sure. So, you know, I think I mentioned a few of them already, but I'll just kind of reiterate and tell you about some other things. So first of all, you know, as I started at the beginning, my background is University of Miami. So my GI fellowship was at University of Miami. I spent 3 years there and it was great. But, you know, I don't think there was any paucity of things to do in Binghamton. I would say, first of all, the town itself is really nice. I really enjoyed living in Binghamton. I think, you know, as a physician, you know, getting into medical school is real hard. So, you know, one of the nice things about the campus, and again, I'm going to go into extracurriculars, but, you know, you need an environment where you can kind of bunker down and study to get into medical school. And Binghamton, you know, campus and Binghamton University definitely gave me that. Again, on the flip side, there were plenty of things to do in the town. You know, as I mentioned, I was on the fencing team for a short period of time. I was very into martial arts and taking different forms of karate when I was at Binghamton. And I participated both in clubs at Binghamton and in different organizations in the town of Binghamton and the local town of Vestal. Again, I did get involved in medicine through emergency medical, EMS, emergency medical services. I took an EMT class at one of the local hospitals. There are some very good hospitals in Binghamton, which include Binghamton General and Wilson, which I believe are still there. Is that correct, Joe? Yeah, so, you know, those hospitals were great places to do EMS. The medical school from upstate, which I believe is in Syracuse. Again, I apologize, I didn't attend there, but they do have medical students rotating there. So there is opportunities to sort of, you know, do activities that will lead you into medicine. So, you know, I had a great time in Binghamton. I made a lot of great friends that I still communicate with today. And it was a good environment both to study and to sort of expand my horizons while I was in college.
Yeah. Kimberly, do you remember any extracurricular activities that might have inspired you to find your way?
I do recall, I remember being involved in the homecoming committee my freshman year. And there was an acting troupe called the DC Players. So that was it Dickinson Community? Dickinson Community Players. Yes. I didn't want to be an actor or anything, but I just loved the vibe of everybody. It was a really cool group to be involved with. I did that for 1 or 2 years, I believe. I did play intramurals as well. I used to play in high school. I did volleyball and track. And my senior year, my junior year, they allowed girls soccer. So my senior year, we actually had shirts with our numbers on, not just a tie-dye t-shirt. So in college, I did play intramural indoor soccer, which was frighteningly different than being on a big field. So I think I've always done sports where growing up, where it was team oriented. Ironically, now I do so much that's solo, you know, running, cycling. I'm getting into triathlons, being involved with the Los Angeles Triathlon Club. I think that's sort of on my plate now. I've been with them, supporting them business-wise for about 5 years, but team, being around in teams, and seeing other people try and fail and get the wind knocked out of them and helping them back up. There's always something that goes along with the sports. But then I also always worked. And I think that, not like you have to put in a full-time job while you're going to school, but there is something that you get out of being outside the bubble and out with the people, you know, that are different, in a different situation, different walk of life, a different social status, a different education. And, you know, I worked in some restaurants. I worked in a bar. I worked in TGI Fridays for sure. That's where I started doing stand-up comedy, making people laugh. And and so I think having anything that looks like a little bit of job, I never did an internship. I actually just had jobs. But there's something about that. You learn how to, you know, you understand, like, you know, in exchange of funds for time, you understand who you have to, you know, respect, even if you don't want to have to follow all the rules. But it was nice to, you know, have that world to step in and getting some street smarts while you're in the academic world at the same time. So yeah, there you go.
Okay. So we have literally 2 minutes, but I want to make sure, Carrie, if it's okay with you, and I would include you, let's just go around real fast. Any, you know, 10th, 15th second bit of advice maybe that we could give our students as they look forward to the next step in their lives, whether it be, you know, admitted to the right fit college, university, or looking out to their careers. So let's just go around real fast and give it a quick one to Carrie, start off.
Sure. I will certainly start by just say, get involved. You know, all of the panelists here, myself included, and I'm sure Joe, you know, it's not just about the academics in college, it's about everything outside of that as well. So making sure to get involved, whether it's with student groups, whether it's intramurals, whatever your passion is, you know, making sure to make that a college experience a well-rounded one is certainly makes the experience that much more worthwhile.
Agreed. Now, Jean, what do you think?
Same, like I think she just said, get involved, have fun, and savor the moment, because you will never have another opportunity to have the next 4 years of college. So, and study abroad. That's one thing people don't talk about often.
Yes. Ian.
Yeah, again, I would say save money. Yeah, I like Joe, your introduction. You know, to me, like public Ivy sounds like a little bit of a pitch, but it's absolutely not a pitch. If you're thinking about going to graduate school and moving on, you know, it gets very expensive. And again, you know, I spent 7 years postgraduate accruing loans, and there was nothing that stood out more to me from Binghamton, again, forgetting about all the great experiences I had, that I did not have a huge loan from undergraduate. And I think you need to look at the cost of school.
Good point. Good point. Gerardo.
Yeah, I'd say pretty similar to what Carrie and Magine said, get involved. I met some of the closest friends that I'm ever going to have at Binghamton. I know those relationships I've developed that are going to last a lifetime. So I looked at that by getting involved. So college is what you make of it. Whatever you do, go out there, have fun. Academics are important, but just remember you're there to have a good time.
That's right. Kimberly.
Pressure.
Don't be scared of anything. Really, you've got so many things going in your direction. I believe that one of the most important things is through getting involved and through what everyone else is saying, is that you build relationships, not just have some friends, but you start understanding what it means to network and build relationships. I think the most important question you can ever ask in your life is when you ask for help, is when you actually ask someone to help you understand or see or try or do something. So ask for help, ask questions, ask why and why not, and also ask how you can help someone else.
Good Good point. Erica.
I would just say be open. You know, college is the time where you're going to be exposed to new ideas, new people, different academic fields, career paths you've never heard of. And don't be so set on like, this is what I'm going to do, that you don't give those other things a chance. So just be open.
Outstanding. Thank you all, panelists and Erica, Carrie, everybody. You guys are wonderful. And I'm glad that our students joined us today and families. Again, we love Binghamton. We hope you heard that message strong. We think Binghamton is wonderful. You know, we're going to have to leave now. It's just a little after four, but if you have more questions, we're going to actually have counselors live chat today until 5 o'clock. So if you want to just go to our website, binghamton.edu /visit, click on, you could live chat with an admissions counselor up till five. So again, I want to say thank you to everybody. What a great, great session we had today. And we're wishing you students the best of luck in your college searches. Okay. Bye, everyone.
Bye.